Elizabeth Arden and Helena Rubinstein have been called titans of the cosmetic industry. Their lives and careers are the subject of a musical called War Paint, now at the Nederlander Theater on West 41st Street, and they are being portrayed by two wonderful actresses, Christine Ebersole and Patti LuPone, both two-time Tony Award winners, whom I hope won't be offended by my calling them titans of musical theater. Doug Wright wrote the show's book, Scott Frankel composed the music, and I'm very pleased that it brings them, and a return visit by Christine Ebersole to our show. Thank you all for being here.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely.
And unfortunately, Patti LuPone, who was also scheduled to join us, has had to cancel because she needs to take a couple of days off to rest her voice. She didn't do the performances yesterday?
No, she did. She missed both shows yesterday.
Well, that's one of the problems all singers face. Even, I mean, I could do this
show with a little bit of a throat. It's a very delicate instrument. It's a very delicate muscle. So you're basically, your day revolves around what your voice is doing.
And you're performing in 8 shows a week, 6 nights, 2 matinees.
Yes.
You're on stage almost all the show. How difficult is it to keep your voice healthy show after show?
Well, you have to be very conscientious. You really do. And I think that especially doing a musical, your entire day revolves around the evening performance, or of course if you have 2 shows, then it revolves around that whole day. And trying to speak minimally, and there's certain things you can't eat, that are certain things you can't drink.
Dairy products before you go
Well, it's not so much that for me, but I have acid reflux. I get acid reflux, so I have to be very careful about the things that I eat because, you know, of what it does to your vocal cords. So it's challenging, but it's just kind of, you have to kind of look at it as an athletic endeavor, really, and just kind of pace yourself. And you still give 100%, but you give. Patti said something really interesting, something like you work on your investment and not your capital. So you don't want to deplete the capital because then you got nothing. So.
Doug, this show was inspired by a book also called War Paint by the British historian Lindy Woodhead. Was it her idea to compare Arden and Rubinstein, who according to legend never actually met, although their Manhattan offices were just around the corner from each other?
That's actually true. It was Lindy's rather brilliant idea that it was their rivalry that fueled each of them to greater and greater heights. Arguably, it was their game of one-upsmanship that led to every product you find on the shelves at Sephora. Elizabeth Arden would invent mascara, and the next summer at the World's Fair in the swimming pavilion, Helena Rubinstein would introduce waterproof mascara. So it was their perpetual game of attempting to beat one another. And in fact, they never met. They wouldn't even refer to each other by name. Helena Rubinstein called Elizabeth Arden the other one, and Elizabeth Arden would only refer to Rubinstein as that dreadful woman. So Lindy's book was really, along with a documentary on PBS called The Powder and the Glory, those two sources were our primary sources in creating the musical.
But the sense you get from seeing the show is that they probably would have found an awful lot in common. The only reason they hated each other was because they were rivals in the business world.
Yeah, I think that was, in a way, their tragedy. I think they were both women at a time when women couldn't compete in business against men, and these two women did. They were the only women with large corporations doing a multinational business, and they were each at one time, respectively, the richest woman in the world, and so they achieved things that were singular to them, and one can only imagine if they'd let down their guard, they might have found genuine empathy and understanding in one another because they were both so uniquely positioned in the world.
Was one of the challenges of writing this show figuring out how to have the two women appear on stage at the same time and even sing duets together while it's quite clear to the audience that they're not actually together?
if they'd come into frequent contact, that would have been easy enough to write, but it might have been a tad bit unremarkable theatrically. Because to a book writer, I think, the fact they never met becomes a delicious challenge, a puzzle to solve. And so, of course, audiences coming to see the show, knowing that we have two of the most remarkable leading ladies in the history of American musical theater, are rather eager to see them together. And rest assured, that happens repeatedly, but through various theatrical conventions that bring them together, even though history may not have done so.
Well, and in fact, the composer was very keen to not only see them together, but hear them together. So we find ways for them to be singing perhaps a joint united thought, but in different locations, or to imagine what they might say to the other one if they had an opportunity to be face to face.
We'll both sing about the sacrifices they've had to make along the way to become successful, and how they had to fight to maintain control in a world that assumed that a man would actually be behind any successful company.
Yes, I mean, they were real trailblazers in that way, in terms of gender and in terms of being ahead of the curve. You know, we were very fortunate to have Secretary Clinton at the opening night performance last week, and I was struck as she watched songs with titles like If I'd Been a Man, thinking, well, you know, of course, glass ceilings and all, how much has changed positively for women since the time that was portrayed in the musical, and also conversely, how much hasn't changed, and how difficult it is still to this day for powerful and accomplished women to be recognized and admired.
Wasn't Warpaint's creative team pretty much the same one that worked on Grey Gardens? Michael Grief directed both. Michael Corey wrote the lyrics. Doug, you wrote the book. Christine, you were one of the stars. In fact, you won your second Tony for that, didn't you?
Yes.
You're not bragging, are you?
You said it.
And nominated for a Tony. Scott, you were nominated also for a Tony for that, and you won the ASCAP Richard Rogers New Horizons Award, the Frederick Lowe Award for Dramatic Composition.
Those guys were pretty good, Richard Rogers and Frederick Lowe. I'm happy to be in that company.
But I hear that you and Doug go back even further than your collaboration on
We Grey do. Gardens. The dirty secret is that Doug and I went to university together in the 1800s.
We would eat lunch together and opine about the state of the American musical theater, as I recall. It took us about 30 years to work together, but we've stayed in touch ever since those dining hall days.
But does it feel like you're getting a head start when you begin a project with a creative team with whom you've already established some kind of a comfortable relationship?
I think definitely. You know, musicals are by their very nature particularly collaborative idioms, the synthesis of text and singing and performance and lyrics. And so if you have a shorthand working relationship, as we did with the very happy collaboration on Grey Gardens that you mentioned, we have an advantage. We'll get together in a room and start to brainstorm, and there's usually a mutual respect and camaraderie there. And whoever, we usually have this adage that whoever has the best idea gets to run with it, so we stick with that.
Although you did use the term comfortable, and I would describe our collaboration as anything but. We all get very heated. But the wonderful thing about working with these guys, even when we're shouting at pitch volume, is that everyone always fights for the best possible choice on behalf of the show. No one ever fights on behalf of their own ego. And so we can break into furious argument about something and then 2 minutes later dissolve into laughter.
So but I think it's because we've all been in therapy for so long. I think that we're able to really put down the ego.
Exactly. Well, we don't even have 50 minutes for this.
Touche.
My guests are Doug Wright, who wrote the book for Warpaint, Scott Frankel, who composed the music, and Christine Ebersole, who stars as Elizabeth Arden. But she was born with a very different name. Florence Nightingale.
Yes, Florence Nightingale Graham. Mm. Florence Nightingale, of course, was a very popular name during the time, but it wouldn't really translate into a cosmetic name.
She was going to be a nurse for the longest time, uh-huh, as befits her name, but then she decided and once actually said, it's just those sick people, they're so unattractive.
Before you got involved in the show, were you aware of how large a role Elizabeth Arden and Helena Rubinstein played in creating today's multi-million dollar U.S. cosmetics industry?
Well, I was certainly aware of Elizabeth Arden because of the Red Door Salon, and aware of Helena Rubinstein as well when I was younger. But I didn't really, of course, know anything about their background. I didn't really think about it. Mm. But now I really understand what trailblazers they were, because if you just walk into Sephora, I mean, whoa. You know, they paved the way for that.
And it becomes clear when you're watching this that they were marketing geniuses. Mm-hmm. Probably haven't been given enough credit for that.
No, absolutely not. I mean, it's... But, you know, the proof is in the pudding.
They were selling women a product they hadn't, the women didn't know that they would want or even need. Cosmetics mm-hmm. had the reputation of only being for actresses and prostitutes before they started.
Nothing That's against right. actresses and prostitutes, though.
That's right.
Some of my best friends.
Not that there's anything wrong with it.
But Arden was especially visionary in that regard, and she knew that she needed to broaden the market if it was going to become an everyday item and a part of every woman's morning ritual. And so she needed to find a bright, young, aggressive, interesting, engaged women that she could share her product with, and she did in the suffragettes. So she gave free Arden lipstick to suffragettes, and if you were walking down the street in New York as a young woman in, say, 1917 and saw a fellow lady pass you with Arden lipstick, you knew she was a sister in the fight for the vote.
Mm. I mean, they also both recognized very early on the importance of packaging and advertising in terms of cosmetics, because, I mean, ultimately, it's lanolin and water and perfume and a fairly consistent limited number of ingredients, but in terms of putting it in exquisite Lalique packaging or a pink bow that Arden was so famous for, the
everything
the
pink. Was pink, and I gather your dressing room is pink now.
It is
are
pink.
You getting sick of pink?
I'm sorry you didn't get a chance to see it.
She also gets to sing a song in Act Two, would you believe, called pink.
Pink. Yes. I remember. The show covers 30 years of history, and one of the ways we know is the amazing costumes. They really set the tone, but there seem to be so many costume changes. Are you going crazy backstage?
I have a really wonderful dresser that is very helpful. Yeah, because if you could have the cameras backstage to see what goes on backstage, that's really some of the most exciting moments of theater. Because how it all gets transformed in a matter of seconds. And I mean, they run back on stage. You know, there's this one point where I have to change my wig, change my shoes, take off all my jewelry, all the clothes, put new clothes on, a new wig, and it's less than a minute. And you just have this all of a sudden these people just start piling on you and you're just throwing stuff off and putting stuff on. And it's really kind of thrilling if you're just standing apart from it to just kind of watch it. Think, mm-hmm. oh my gosh, this is really what goes on backstage mm-hmm. that people don't see. You know, they just see the magic that's on there, but to see what goes into putting it on.
And Patty wears even more jewelry because Helena Rubinstein just covered herself with jewelry.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
She had Rubinstein had this thing where when she was on her honeymoon, she and her husband got in a fight, and she developed this trait, which continued for the rest of her life, that when there was a fight, she would go out and buy a piece of jewelry, and it would be from the husband. That was their shtick.
But you did mention the remarkable clothes, and Kathy Zuber does, both our leading ladies, so many wonderful favors, because they look unstoppably glamorous throughout the show, and they're thrilling women to dress, and she does it resplendently. But she's also a writer's best friend, because when you're telling a story that lasts three decades, you always need to note the passage of time, and you find yourself, you know, writing absolutely deplorably bad expositional lines like, well, it's 1946 and I'd love a cup of coffee. And the great thing about Kathy is she so nails the era in the clothes that when a character enters, you know exactly where you are in time. Mm-hmm. And that's a real gift.
We're going to take a little break here, and we'll come back with more with my guests, Doug Wright, who wrote the book for War Paint, which is currently at the Nederlander Theater on West 41st Street in an open run.
Exactly.
And Scott Frankel, who composed the music, and Christine Ebersole, who stars as Elizabeth Arden. Stay with us for more. And later in the show, David Bellows tells the improbable story behind Victor Hugo's novel Les Miserables. Then Kelly O'Hara and Bill Irwin, who are starring in the Master Voices production of Babes in Toyland, They'll be joined by artistic director Ted Sperling. We're broadcasting today's show live from the Green Space, and you're listening to WNYC, WNYC.org. We're also available as a podcast.
WNYC receives support from the Apollo Theater, presenting the WOW Women of the World Festival. Events include the Abby Lincoln Tribute Concert on Saturday, May 6th, featuring Diane Reeves, Dee Dee Bridgewater, and Esperanza Spalding. Info at wowapollo.com. The New Jersey Performing Arts Center, presenting Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater on Mother's Day weekend, with programs that include three NJPAC premieres and company classics, May 12th through 14th. Tickets at njpac.org. Rutgers University, presenting a day of music, dance, health tips, and more on Rutgers Day, Saturday, April 29th, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. on the Rutgers campuses in New Brunswick, Camden, and Newark. Free for all. More at explore.rutgers.edu.
On Saturdays, WNYC is all about the news. News we investigate.
We shouldn't have to wonder or guess whether the government is going too far in its surveillance of Americans.
And news we laugh at.
Sean Spicer has had to spin so fast, he actually corkscrewed into the earth.
The news you want, the break you need. Saturdays on 93.9 FM, WNYC.
We're back with Christine Ebersole, who stars as Elizabeth Arden, opposite Patti LuPone, who's playing Helena Rubinstein in a new musical called War Paint, currently at the Nederlander Theater on West 41st Street. Also with us is Doug Wright, who wrote the show's book, and Scott Frankel, who composed the music. And we have been playing some of the instrumental music from the show because the original cast album has not yet been recorded.
Well, we did record it Sunday and Monday of this past week, so in a marathon 15-hour recording session. I'm very excited to dive in with the mix. I think we've captured some fantastic performances. Very pleased so far.
And the show includes 20 original songs plus a finale. That seems like a lot to me. Is that number typical for a musical of the scope?
Yeah, that's it. There are no hard and fast rules, but I think that seems like a pretty representative amount.
And when you're writing the songs, beyond the all those questions about collaborating, who wrote, do you write the lyrics first, the music and all of that, do you have to deal with Doug and find out what he would like you to put in the song so that you can continue the story?
I mean, we usually get together and talk about potential song moments. I mean, one of the very, very first songs I think we wrote for the show was a song called Behind the Red Door. I mean, we knew that there was this iconic red door, of course, on Fifth Avenue, and that image was burned fast in everyone's collective consciousness.
And door has so many words to rhyme with it.
It does indeed. And happily, the lyricist Michael Corey found every single one of them to use. But yeah, there's a lot of give and take. In this instance too, the knowing for me, having Patty and Christine on board very early on gave me a great opportunity to write for their each of them have such individual instruments. You know, Patty is known for that clarion trumpet belt, that thrilling Evita gypsy belt voice. Christine has this ethereal, silvery, exquisitely clear soprano. But that said, both women were extremely game to mix it up musically. So sometimes Christine is singing the lower part and Patty is singing the higher part. They're both, in addition to being great singing actresses, they're both phenomenal musicians with wonderful ears. So as a composer, I call one of them a Ferrari and the other one a Maserati.
And did you write with their voices in mind?
Very, very much so.
Because other people are going to perform the show in the future.
Well, yes, I certainly hope so. But it was definitely written for them.
And I'm assuming you sat at the piano, the two of you, Brill Building style. No.
Well, you know, the tricky thing is when I sit at the piano trying to be Rubinstein and Arden, and then I in my limited nasal Midwestern baritone, and then I have to present material to Patty and Christine, and it's always my fear that they're going to look at me like, "What the hell are you thinking?" But they're somehow able to see through my performance limitations.
Christine, is this the first time that you and Patty have worked together?
Yes.
Although they're rivals, your rivals in the show, every photograph I've seen of you has you hanging on each other. Can I assume that your personalities and performance styles complement each other off stage?
I believe so, yeah. I mean, it's very complimentary. I have tremendous respect for Patty. She's an amazing performer. And as I've said to her, and I would say it to all of you, she makes me a better performer.
Hmm. She says she started acting when she was 4 years old, so she's been in the business for over 60 years. You started fairly young too, but not that young.
No, I was going to be a nurse too.
Oh.
Florence Nightingale Ebersole.
That's right. No, I didn't get into the business until I was 20. I think unconsciously I was kind of, you know, moving in that direction, but it wasn't a conscious decision until I was 20.
And was it theater? Because you've also worked in movies and in television. You were even a member of the Saturday Night Live cast during the 81-82 season.
Yes. What was the question?
What did you imagine you'd be doing when you decided to give up nursing?
Oh, I don't know if I ever gave it up, but I think as a child, that was kind of what I was interested in. But my parents were very supportive. I remember being in college, and it came time to choose my major. And my mother asked me on the phone, well, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I don't know. Maybe I'll be a lawyer, or maybe I'll be a psychotherapist. She said, no, get into music, get into theater. I said, okay. And my
good
father was the same way. He said, I knew from the first day I laid eyes on you in the hospital, you were going to grow up to be a great dramatic actress. No pressure, Dad, you know. So.
Usually it's the other way around. The parents say, no, don't go into show business.
Yeah.
Become a doctor.
I think maybe I was, you know, they were living vicariously through me. My mother was my first music teacher, and my dad was my first acting teacher.
Now, I can't imagine Weekend Update today without Donald Trump as major subject matter. What was it like when you were doing it?
It wasn't as politically charged as it is now. I don't remember it that way. You know, of course,
Ronald Reagan was president.
I remember singing once about Gaddafi, and it was a takeoff on Jordache jeans. You know, he's got the look the third world is after. He wants to be the OPEC master. Thrilling, woo-woo, killing, woo-woo, invading Chad. Gaddafi has the look that's bad. You know, stuff like that.
Do you remember the lyrics to all the songs that you have done over the years?
And I remember it. And then there was a voiceover that says, whether you're invading your territorial waters or just cutting off a criminal's hand, do it in style with clothes by Colonel Muammar Gaddafi. Yeah, so I guess it was political in a sense, but it just seems in overload today, you know?
Doug, it's interesting, especially at this moment in U.S. history, to realize that both Rubinstein and Arden were immigrants. Where were they born, and how did they wind up coming to the United States?
Yes, that's extremely important, and the show pays tribute to it, I hope. Elizabeth Arden was actually born on a farm in Ontario to humble parents, and then when she came to the States, really cultivated the aura of American aristocracy, as if she'd stepped off the proverbial Mayflower, but that was the result of rigorous elocution lessons and a lot of self-conscious betterment. And similarly, Helena Rubinstein came from the Jewish quarter in Krakow, and again, her father was a peddler for part of his career, but she too would claim to be lost European royalty. And
she came here through a more circuitous route. She was in Australia, then established herself in London for a time.
That's absolutely right. Her mother would cook this skin cream on the stove, and it became rather celebrated in her hometown. And so when her father arranged a marriage that she didn't want to commit to, she stole her mother's recipe and hopped aboard a freighter and went to Australia and began selling the skin cream, and then to Europe, and then finally, when she'd established a very firm success in both of those regions, she ultimately came to America and face to face with Arden. But again, when we talk about how different the women were, this is a way in which they were profoundly similar, because they were both hardworking immigrants with a lot of ambition and somewhat invented pasts.
Doug Wright is the author of the book for this new musical called War Paint. He is here with us. Scott Frankel composed the music. Christine Ebersole stars as Elizabeth Arden, and it is currently on stage at the Nederlander, one of those wonderful old New York theaters,
beautiful,
on West 41st Street. This is WNYC, WNYC.org. We're broadcasting live from the green space. So let's talk a bit more about their situation. So these two women come as immigrants and establish themselves, and they're not always embraced by New York society for various reasons, partly because they're in business. Also, one of the subplots has to do with the role of the men in their lives and the conflict over who gets credit.
It's true. Both of them had significant men in their lives. Elizabeth Arden's husband, Tommy Lewis, was also one of her employees. And at one point she said to him, remember, darling, it's my company, you just work here. But there was always a danger that he would get the lion's share of the credit for a work that she actually achieved, and that was something she was aware of, and it was important to her that she be accorded her own success. And similarly, Helena Rubinstein had a series of marketing directors that worked for her over time. We've compressed them into a single character on our show for narrative clarity, but again, the women weren't largely in the workforce at the time, so it's remarkable to consider that these women oversaw certainly women in their workforce who were working in the spas and offering the treatments and things like that, but their executives were almost uniformly male, so they were commandeering huge staffs of men, which, again, for the era, is pretty remarkable.
And of course, there were real consequences to both of their personal lives, I think, being so single-mindedly devoted to their careers. And in a plot twist, all the more delicious because it's true, Elizabeth Arden and her husband split up, and subsequently he went to work for her arch rival, Helena Rubinstein. And inversely, Helena Rubinstein's right-hand PR man went to work for Elizabeth Arden. So the men switch, which is a delightful and delicious happenstance, again, that happens to be true.
And they're played wonderfully by John Dossett and Douglas Sills.
Indeed, fantastic gentlemen of all great character.
We should mention that there is also a fairly large cast, although the people are taking on more than one role. They dance, they sing, they become many different characters.
Elizabeth Arden has four leggy, impossibly young, tall, glamorous Arden girls in pink culottes who populate her salon, and Helena has four sturdier Central European women who populate her more scientifically minded emporium.
I don't want to give away too much of the plot and how things develop, but there is an important moment where they wind up having to testify before a Senate committee. Is that part of the real story?
That is part of the real story. Senator Royal Copeland of New York held cosmetic safety hearings in 1938, and it resulted in the Cosmetics Act of 1939 and federal oversight, because at the time there was no policing organization overlooking the content in cosmetics, and there were even fatalities. And in particular, there was a product called Lash Lure, manufactured by neither Arden nor Rubinstein, but that it was causing women to go blind. And so there was a real necessity for these hearings.
And they were putting lead in some of their
there
products.
There was lead in the makeup and
mercury.
And a host of other things. You know, even to this day, the primary red in lipstick is what's called carmine dye, which is made from ground-up Amazonian beetles, ladies. Both companies were called before Congress. In actual historical fact, their aide-de-camps, their male executives, testified on their behalf. Neither lady gave personal testimony, but obviously when you have Christine Ebersole and Patti LuPone and you can give them fabulous Senate room drama, you're going to put it firmly in their camp. So in the musical, both women testify personally.
And I'm sure that one of the things you point out, that they were very uncomfortable about listing the ingredients on their labels because they considered their secret recipes to be an important part of their success.
And they didn't make for attractive labeling. I mean, lamb fat, and there's something called ambergris, which is the ossified vomit of whales. Yeah. It makes a wonderful exfoliant.
I thought it was a basic ingredient to perfumes for many years.
Yes, that too. Yeah.
Moby
that
Dick.
Too. Absolutely.
They're grabbing up ambergris.
So the actual ingredients are not appetizing at all. And so for that reason as well, they didn't want them disclosed.
Wasn't War Paint performed for the first time in Chicago's Goodman Theater for several months last
we
summer?
We did. We were very fortunate to do an out-of-town run in Chicago last summer. Actually, the Chicago area, Christine's hometown, right? From Winnetka?
Winnetka.
And you're the big noise from Winnetka?
She is the big noise from Winnetka.
I'm the big noise from Winnetka.
It was a great opportunity. You know, when you see a show on its feet, a new musical for the first time, there are certain things we know we have right and other things that we can improve on, and the audience proves invaluable.
So how much has changed?
Fair amount, actually. We've written, I'm going to say, maybe 30% of the show since Chicago. So that means new songs, replaced songs, new texts. Many some new costumes from Kathy Zuber, some new fantastic hats. A lot of things have changed, I think, for the better.
Before every show nowadays, there's an announcement about turning off your cell phone. And if Patty were here, I would ask her about her famous incident with somebody whose phone went off. I still hear phones go off all the time in theater. Is that how much of a distraction is that, Christine?
Well, I haven't heard it too much. I think they're afraid of what the consequences might be. But
especially with Patty.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah, she takes care of business. But
she is Sicilian, after all.
Exactly. But I think as an audience member, I have been in the past very distracted by people with their phones just in their laps, and these bright lights coming, yes. And it's just unbelievably distracting.
Sometimes they're texting as well.
Yes, they're texting during the show.
I mean, it is a very delicate covenant. We all get together under one roof, and we're in the present, and we're trying to transport everyone back to a different time, and everyone needs to close their eyes and make believe, and that's very fragile. And if a phone goes off, or if someone's texting, or if someone's eating potato chips, it can really take you out of the moment.
I have to say, I was at the theater during one of our previews, and this just stunned me. This woman seated next to me took out dental floss, and she flossed every tooth in her gaping mouth, and it made me so irate. And I kept staring at her, trying to, like, you know, get her attention, just with the sort of force of my rage. And I didn't. She finished and put it away and continued to enjoy the program, I guess, with cleaner, brighter teeth.
Maybe inspired by these two giants of cosmetics, but I hate to end this on that gruesome note. But we've run out of time. I'll keep that image in my mind during the next interview. Just one more thing. The orchestra sounds like it has 50 or 60 instruments. It's a small orchestra pit. It's just amazing.
I have to say, our hats off to our amazing orchestrator, Bruce Coughlin, who takes our 13-member band and makes it sound at least twice as much.
And it must be great singing on top of that kind of
really
support.
It's really a very, very exquisite experience.
Thank you all so much for being here. I said this is an open run. Do you all, Christine, you expect to stay there for a while?
Yes.
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 We're very lucky.
Come and see it.
Come see us at the 41st Street at the Nederlander. War Paint the Musical.
Yes.
And my great thanks to Christine Ebersole, Doug Wright, and Scott Frankel for being our guests today. It's been a real pleasure. We're broadcasting live from the Green Space. By the way, if you want more information about War Paint, you can visit our show page at WNYC.org. We'll tell you everything about tickets and such. Next up, David Bellows with the improbable story behind Victor Hugo's novel, Les Miserables. Then later on the show, Anthony Bourdain and Lydia Tenaglia, who have made a documentary about Jeremiah Tower, and they will be joined by the legendary Jeremiah Tower as well. You're listening to WNYC, WNYC.org. We are broadcasting live from the Green Space.